Okay, I believe a lot of us living on earth, whether we are young, whether we are old, all of us, we usually like to choose the easy way out. I mean, most of us, we like to keep things easy, we like to relax, we like to enjoy ourselves. We do not like to take things the hard way, or we do not like to always go and chase after challenges. Many of us, we tend to like it when, you know, we can really have a very smooth sailing and easy life. So, because of this common desire that exists in people, do you sometimes then wonder, why is it that some people, they actually willingly accept certain challenges in their life, even with informed decision, meaning to say that they are not tricked into receiving certain challenges. Have you ever wondered why people like to willingly pick up certain challenges? We just came back from a wedding lunch. So during the wedding, the best man is very, very cute. When he made a speech for the groom, he actually said, "Oh, you know this groom, he's a very stingy guy. And this groom, he didn't shower every day. You know, I don't know why the best man said such things during the groom's wedding." And then he finished it off with saying, "Oh, all the best to the wife. You know, now you have to take this challenge of a smelly and a stingy husband." So a lot of times, when we see, for example, two people getting married, they know they have to adjust to a lot of different things, different challenges they need to adapt to, and different things they need to struggle with. And they know that when two persons, for example, enter into a wedding, or not wedding, a marriage, there's a lot of things they need to grapple with. But still, why do they willingly enter into a marriage? And when we consider, for example, a couple trying to give birth or give birth to children, they, of course, they know if they want to become parents, they will have to endure and take up the challenge of the economic costs, the financial costs of raising up a kid, and also the social costs, adjustment in living and adjustment in lifestyle, a lot of things they have to go through, even emotional costs. You know, sometimes the child will give them heart pain, will make them worry. I mean, being a parent with common sense, they all know these are the challenges they will have to take up the moment they give birth to a child. But why are there so many people willingly taking up such challenges in life? Sometimes when we went traveling, you know, last time we went traveling, they show us, the tour guides show us certain mountains where people might go last time, gold mining. Then when we look at the mountains and the tracks, it's also difficult to walk. The mountains are so challenging to even enter. But why did people actually willingly take up those challenges, go up the very dangerous mountain just to mine the gold? The reason is very simple when we talk about gold mining, because we are all aware the value of gold is far surpassing the challenges that one has to endure. So with all these examples in mind, we know sometimes as odd, as strange as it may seem to other people who are non-Christian, certain Christians, no, we actually also willingly go through certain challenges as we follow Jesus. We willingly take up the cross, sometimes the ridicule from people around us, a lot of challenges, a lot of adjustment in our timetable, our weekly schedule, and all these things comes with the cost of following Jesus. And sometimes it may seem very, very weird, very, very strange to others. Why would you Christians want to do such things? What a lovely Saturday afternoon. You can go and have high tea, go and relax, go and watch a movie. And in your daily living, you just need to go through a very simple life. Why need to be so troublesome? But actually, the higher the cost of following Jesus, it reflects the higher the value of the salvation, the higher the value of the relationship God has to offer us. Because the higher price you are willing to pay, it signifies the higher the value of the thing you're paying for. You know, a lot of people pay a lot for diamond. They didn't even ask why diamond costs so much, because they know that is a very valuable object. So when it comes to following Jesus, actually, when the cost of discipleship is so high, it tells us ourselves that this salvation is worth it. And it also reflects to people around us that this is really amazing, an amazing gift from God. And you set people thinking, why would this bunch of believers want to sacrifice their time, their energy, their thoughts, and their lifestyles just to follow Christ? It would set them thinking, what's the value of the thing that they are chasing after. So today when we read the passage from today, from the Bible, we will realize Jesus is giving his disciples a very challenging command about following him. You know, Jesus, when we shared last week, when Jesus recruited his followers, he didn't go according to the modern HR strategies. You know, come and follow me, you'll get a high pay, you'll get a comfortable life. But Jesus said, you come, you follow me, and I'll be like sending you like sheep among the wolves. There'll be challenges, there'll be certain risks involved. But as I said, Jesus has to make the cause of discipleship very clear and very high so that we can cherish the gospel that we have from God. So today, we will read from Matthew chapter 10, and because it's a long passage, we will take it segment by segment. So let's turn to Matthew chapter 10. We'll read from verse 24 first. Matthew chapter 10, verse 24 to 25. So this tells us a very familiar verse which we have come across before. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their master. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So we'll pause here. We'll take it bit by bit so that you all will not be overwhelmed by the long passage. From this short two verse, we know that if we want to claim the blessings and the promise of Jesus, it is two-sided. We follow Jesus not just to get his blessing, but there's also an inevitable cost of following him. So, you know, we hear a lot of people, maybe the preachers of modern churches, saying that, you know, you come and follow Jesus, you will not need to go through suffering. Everything will be smooth for you. Whatever you want, whether you want a life partner, you want money, you want success, you want career prospect, everything is in Christ. A lot of such proclamation is actually giving people many kind of false hope. And today, as we reflect upon our own faith journey with God, we need to ask, how do you know that your faith journey, how do you know we have lived out our Christian faith fairly well, fairly according to God's will? How do we know? I mean, a lot of people saying that, yes, you know, I attended church faithfully, I pray every day, I pray. But what's the content of our prayer? Is it praying for our own needs, our own desires? I mean, how do we know that we have lived out the Christian faith in a way that is pleasing to God? How do we know? If we are truly leading a serious Christian life, and if we are living a non-compromised faith living, more or less, to a certain extent, we will go through or we will face certain very light or very severe persecution, to a certain extent. I mean, if the gospel, if the God that we are sharing is absolute enough, if we do not just share about a generic God, you know, God love us, God help us, this generic God will not cause any persecution to come to us, because everybody will say, yeah, you have your God, I have my God. But if we share to the extent that it doesn't compromise God's truth, only Jesus, no one else, then we will start to have some light or severe persecution, certain opposition, certain resistance to a certain extent. So we have to check ourselves. If up to now, when we are living our faith, when we are leading this faith journey, if until now we didn't even get a person's twitch of the eyebrow and we didn't get any slightest resistance, it could also mean that we may be living a very compromised faith living. And you know, actually, the Bible even prepared us already that especially towards the end time, this is a time where when people resist us, when people oppose the gospel, they may even be thinking that they are doing God a service. John 16:2 says that, you know, when people persecute Christians, when people persecute the follower of Christ, they may be even thinking that their persecution is doing God a favor, is doing God a service. So we have come to this point in time that it's inevitable. It's inevitable that we, if we are true believers, we will have to go through certain costs. So although no one voluntarily invite persecution, but as we said many times, but it is, we need to be prepared. I mean, we need to guard our hearts against this false anticipation that, you know, we can be well and safe. We can escape all kinds of resistance. If we are sincere in living a life that God wills, to a certain extent, we must be prepared that even though we didn't invite those opposition, those persecution, it may come to us at a certain point in time. However, as I said just now, the higher the cost of discipleship, we need to confirm that it actually signifies the higher the value of this gospel, the higher the value of this relationship with God. Actually, to a certain extent, if God, He is bold enough to command us to willingly go through the hardship of the cross, to willingly take up our cross and follow Him, then it means that certainly whatever He has in store for us will far exceed all this hardship that is awaiting us. And if, on the other hand, if Satan, he actually bothered to invest his time, invest his efforts to attack us, it also means that Satan is indirectly affirming the effect of the gospel. I mean, if Satan bothers, in other words, if your enemies, if your enemy bother to attack you, if your enemy bother to invest time and energy to threaten us, to a certain extent, the enemy is indirectly also affirming that our faith is right, that our faith can be effective, that our faith can change life, that our faith can earn us, not earn us, can lead us to heaven. Indirectly, Satan, through his attacks, he's actually confirming God's truth, God's word also. So, Jesus has to tell us the full price of following him in today's scripture so that we know that we do not just get an ordinary gospel. It's not just an ordinary piece of good news, but it's really a very important, precious good news that Jesus had for us. And that's why today we will read in this passage that in Jesus' preparation for his disciples, his words contains something that we do not like, threats, but it also contains a lot of assurance. So let's continue reading this Matthew chapter 10. We will read from 17 to 20 first. Matthew 10, 17. This is the first set of threats that we will see. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you'll be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry what to say or how to say it. At that time, you'll be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Some preachers, they use this verse 19 and 20, say, oh, I don't prepare sermon, you know, when the time comes for me to stand on stage, words will be given me and I can preach whatever God tells me. And that's a misuse of this text, because here he says, when you're caught, because no one knows exactly when we'll be suddenly caught by the authorities. But here, God gave us his assurance. The Holy Spirit will offer us timely help. So the tricky thing here is, you know, when we read verse 17 to 20, if you recall the profile of the disciples, who are they? They are not the most eloquent. They are not the smartest people on earth. And who are they facing with? They're actually facing with the worst. With the best debaters. They are faced with the teachers of the law, the Pharisees, even very knowledgeable people. So the challenge and the contrast between the opponents and the disciples are very huge. So when we look at our Christian journey, sometimes along our way, we may also meet, of course, in Singapore, thank God, right now, still we don't have a lot of obvious conflicts with authorities yet. But sometimes we will meet a lot of difficult people. People of higher authority. I mean, maybe in Singapore, as I said, no, but in our mission countries, like those in China and some places, the authorities will not favour overt evangelism. But even now in Singapore, Malaysia, as we consider our views, I mean, do you sometimes feel like you are like the disciples, feel very timid when you face difficult people, people who are more eloquent than you, maybe your classmates, certain kind of your classmates, or certain friends, relatives, who can speak very well, even better than us. And all these people, before we even open our mouth to tell them about Jesus, our heart already sank. We already cannot even think about opening our mouth because they are so eloquent. So the assurance that God gave for us is, no matter what is the situation, don't worry about what to say. The Holy Spirit, in other words, Holy Spirit will surely give us timely help. So this is something we need to confirm. As and when I recently, God has been helping me recall in my own life and in the people that I met in the church. A lot of times, people in the church, we don't possess very special skills or ability. But because God is powerful, a lot of times it is not our ability that counts, but it is our willingness to rely on the Holy Spirit that counts. Because as long as we are willing to look to God, Holy Spirit will give us the timely support that we need. So this is assurance. God is being very practical here. Not just in the Jewish times, also now in our modern times, we will meet a lot of difficult people day in, day out. Even if we didn't step out of our house, even on the social media, there's a lot of eloquent, they say, keyboard warriors. They can say a lot of things, typing, so scary. But at the right time, God will give us the wisdom on how to handle all these people. And the assurance is, if you read verse 18, you'll be brought before governors and kings. It's very scary, but you'll be brought there as witnesses to the Gentiles, to the kings and to the Gentiles. So the assurance is, yes, even though there are persecutions, but persecutions are threats turned opportunities. So the assurance is, God's assurance is always very, whether it's, of course today we are talking about evangelism and mission, but whether it's any other problems in our life, God's work is always amazing where the threat, the problem can be turned around into opportunities to evangelize, to proclaim God's glory. A lot of times we got defeated at the sight of certain threats, certain challenges ahead of us. But to God, He can make use of every opportunity. So He's very realistic here. When God gave us His promise, He didn't, as we always confirm, He didn't say that life as a Christian is a bed of roses. He didn't say that. But He said that, yes, even though there's trouble, I will have victory over those problems. So in other words, the assurance is God's work cannot be deterred by anything, anyone, any authorities. Even though they are kings, they are governors, they are high authorities, they are people more capable than us, more eloquent than us, nothing can deter the work of God if God wants to do it. A lot of times in the course of following Jesus, do you realize one common mentality that we have is one thing? For example, when on the topic of evangelism, we often entertain one thought. Oh, you know, I certainly cannot evangelize in this kind of situation. I certainly cannot evangelize to this group of people. You know, we always have this mindset in our thinking, saying that, yeah, you know, under persecution, how can we ever evangelize? But here, God's assurance is, He wants us to get out of this mindset where we keep thinking that, we keep confining ourselves. Because a lot of Christians, in the course of entertaining a lot of this believing mindset, you realize that a lot of Christians end up being very eloquent evangelists among the Christian community. Oh, they say a lot. They test a lot of perfect will. They talk about a lot of spiritual truth when they are in the Christian community. They talk about intercession, answers, a lot of things only in the church. Once outside the church, once they get out of the church setting, like just now at a wedding banquet, I was trying to think, how do I talk about some God stuff, godly stuff to the people sitting around me. Everybody's attention is on the stage, clapping for the couple, you know, eating the food, and also on children running around. So it's so hard. It's like talking in the church is so easy. But a lot of times, only when we start to try, then you see how Holy Spirit give you the opportunity, give you the wisdom to seep in, to seep in certain conversational points to lead people to God. So, even though there are threats, even though there are challenges, God's assurance is the power of the Holy Spirit will not reduce because of our limitations. So I say again, this is always an encouragement for all of us. Assurance of God is the power of the Holy Spirit will not reduce despite our weaknesses, despite our timidity, despite our constraints that we impose upon ourselves. The power of the Holy Spirit is as great as ever. As long as we are willing to tap on it, we will get to use it bit by bit. So that's the first set of threats and assurance. Difficult situation, higher authorities, but Holy Spirit will give us timely support. Then let's read from verse 21 to 22. There's another set of threats facing believers. Brothers, or verse 21, brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. So this is a very serious thing. Even children will put their parents to death. You will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be safe. So the one who stands firm to the end. To the end refers to what? Of course, it refers to the coming of Jesus again. And if for some of us who didn't live till Jesus returned again, it refers to the end of our lifetime. So safe is not just safe from physical threats, physical life-threatening situation. Because we know there's so many believers throughout church history who has been martyred. So this safe, of course, refers to eternal salvation. And we turn again to verse 34, 34 to 36. It all talks about interpersonal relationship. So verse 34, talk about, do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's enemies will be the members of his household. Wow, so after you read this, nobody want to be Christian anymore, you know? Because why? Especially in this Asian culture and in this Chinese culture, people, the place that people want to preserve most is what? Is the family. We hold family ties, family relationship very dearly. To some of us in the Asian culture, they can even sacrifice a lot for the family. But here Jesus is saying, no, I come to bring some chaos in the family. And the strange thing is, Jesus, he's actually the Prince of Peace. But this peace, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. So why is the Prince of Peace? So there's a paradox, there's a contradiction here. Why is the Prince of Peace bringing chaos to the people in the family? Because this peace is not enjoyed by everyone. Only those who can understand the gospel, only those who are touched by the Holy Spirit, then they can taste the peace that Jesus brings, the peace of even having nothing, but God is with me, I feel peaceful. The peace of being very busy, but because God is with me, God understands me, so I can be peaceful. So this kind of peace can only be tasted, can only be enjoyed by people who are touched by the Holy Spirit. So, of course, then it will bring division because there will be 50% or the other half of people who cannot understand, who cannot accept this kind of peace. What believing in Jesus? I want to believe in myself. And then because of their believing in themselves, they are burdened with a lot of cares and worries of this life. So paradoxically, Jesus, he brings both peace and division. Actually, it's the same good news. But to the one who can receive the good news, it is peace. To the one who cannot receive the good news, it is division. You know, my mother last night always say, my three daughters go to church and turn the whole house upside down. Every time, you know, ancestor worship time, last time is a happy time. Now because all three of you go to church, now our family become upside down. You know, it's divided, it's not united anymore. So to the one who cannot accept the good news, it becomes a division. So we need to ask ourselves, especially when we come to this point in time, that the second threat facing believers is interpersonal struggles. Even people whom we love most, the most intimate relationship, the ones dearest to us. And here, in fact, there's a verse that sounds exaggerating. You'll be hated by everyone, verse 22. You'll be hated by everyone. But of course, we know that's an exaggeration. This everyone, of course, refers to people. Everyone who cannot accept the Bible, the gospel. I mean, for those who can accept the gospel, of course, we won't hate one another. So we need to ask ourselves, I mean, this is something really dear to our hearts. So we need to ask ourselves this question, that Are we sincerely a true disciple of Christ to the effect that if the following of Christ demand that sometimes we cannot help it, but we have to create certain kind of division, not deliberately, but we cannot help it. You know, sometimes when there's a certain, when it comes to certain critical moments where we have to make certain decision, when you need to set yourself apart from maybe ancestor worship or other things, even giving your opinions about certain family issues, there will come a time where we need to ask ourselves, are we such true follower of God that we are willing to even create this kind of division, necessary division in the family? And but the good news is, this kind of division in the family or among people whom we love could just be for a while. It could be just a temporary division. Because if one day we pray hard enough, we set ourselves apart enough, and we stand on our ground firmly enough, one day, even those family members who cannot understand us, who cannot agree with us, one day they can become part of our Christian family as well. And then from there on, the division will change into harmony again among the family members. So a lot of times I realize, sometimes for myself, I also need to struggle. We tend to have this tendency to opt for a temporary harmony in the family. But a lot of times, the reason why I bite the bullet, you know, sometimes, because all of you know I come from a non-Christian family, and sometimes the reason why I can bite my bullet, even though sometimes, you know, mothers especially, they are good at saying things that will prick your heart. It's like, you're really a heartless, ruthless person if you didn't listen to the mother's word. You know, I give birth to you, I give everything for you, I can die for you, and this is how you repay me. A lot of times, the words they say can be so piercing to the heart. But one thing that keep me going is, it is really foolish to sacrifice eternal salvation of our family member in exchange for a temporal or temporary harmony in the family. It's so tempting to just opt for the temporary harmony. It could be between parent and child. It could be between a husband and a wife. The wedding that I just attended just now, the wife is a Christian. The husband is not. Okay, actually, the husband came to our church before, Eugene, if you still remember him. So the wife, wow, when she shared her first thank you speech, the first thing she thanked is thank God. I was so proud of her. Of course, she said thank God for the weather and whatever, but that it didn't rain today. But at least the first thing she thanked is thank God. And the husband looked at her, huh, why are you thanking God? That kind of face. So I can see, you know, sometimes we tend to opt for harmony. It's like between husband and wife. If you are a non-believer, I'm a believer. Okay, as long as we are lovey-dovey, it's all right. You walk your way, I follow my God. A lot of times, it's very easy for us because we all want a comfortable life. But it's really foolish, I say again, to give up eternal salvation of the very person that we love so much in exchange for a temporary harmony or temporary good times that we want to enjoy with them. So that's why when we are facing these kind of threats, there are certain principles that God wants us to stick to, especially in regards to preserving our faith, the absolute faith in Christ. But then again, you ask, you know, a lot of times we are not facing life and death issue. Now if people point a gun at you or at me saying, you want to believe Jesus? Of course you say, you pray for God, pray to God for faith. Okay, I want to profess my faith so that I can go to heaven. But we are not always in a life and death situation every day. So this is a time, you know, we are not living in a time where we say you choose God or family. You know, we're not living in that kind of time now. It's not like God asks you, okay, you choose, you want to choose Jesus, no family. You want to choose family, no God. We are not living in that kind of time now. So how? So how can family and God, or relationship that are dear to us, coexist together in this peaceful time? So when we read such extreme verses in the Bible, later on we will also read, you know, if anyone see the mother, the father, whatever, brother, more important than me, you are not worthy to follow me. You know, when we hear all these very, very demanding, very harsh so-called commands from God, sometimes we also need to balance. Okay, of course, here it says, here it says that even though we will face certain interpersonal struggles, those who stand firm will be safe. meaning to say that we'll have eternal salvation. But again, as I said, when we read all these verses, we need to understand that we need to balance. Jesus is not telling us, you know, I'm here to bring chaos to the family. So all of you go back and start quarreling with your family and your friends about Christianity, how different it is with all your other values. No, we're not going to do that. But we need to balance with maybe other principles in the Bible where God teaches his believers to balance between living right, living honorably, leading a godly living in front of non-believers. You know, when you talk about parent-child, even in Ephesians, for example, this is an example. Ephesians chapter 6, 1 to 4, talks about, you know, children, honor your parents, and all those things that we know is our moral standards. But when God tells us all these things about, you know, we cannot place family above God, but we also, at the same time, at the back of our mind, we need to balance it with the biblical principle of how we should conduct ourselves in front of non-believing people. So the key thing is not about purposely opposing them, but it's about prioritizing our values. Of course, God also wants us to love our family and people around us, and God also wants us to love them with all our hearts, but we cannot allow family to hinder our relationship with God. So, a lot of times, you know, when there's a tension, of course, in daily living, we try our best to please our loved ones. But when it comes to a point where we need to stand up for the faith, we really need to pray that God will help us. Because the one who stands firm will be safe. You and your loved ones. You and your family. Or else, everyone died together. Or else, everyone just got deceived together. Everyone just got bound together by the evil one. And God also not just tell us all this, all these challenges, but God knows, you know, it's so hard. Every time when we hear threats, and every time when we face challenge, our heart feels weak. And that's why God gave us additional assurance. He gave us more assurance in verses 26. Let's turn to verse 26. Okay, it's jumping here and there, but I'm trying to group the relevant themes together. Okay, verse 26. God knows, you know, whether it's about our family members, whether it's about higher authorities, whether it's about people who can speak better than us, God tells us this assurance. 26, so do not be afraid of them. Anyone who opposes the gospel, do not be afraid of them. For there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ears, proclaim from the roofs. In other words, you know, sometimes when Jesus tells his disciples certain things, he says, oh, keep it among yourselves, do not tell others. But here he's saying that the time will come for us to boldly profess the gospel without fear. Whatever we hear from God, just proclaim it loudly and proclaim it clearly. And verse 28, there's another, do not afraid. Jesus tells us three times, do not be afraid. Verse 28, do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. So, who is the one who can destroy both? God. Then verse 29, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. Verse 30, and even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. So you see, there's under the assurance, there's a lot of don't be afraid. God keep repeating this many, many times because God knows how easy it is for humans' hearts to feel weak, to feel strengthless just by looking at the slightest challenge or threats ahead of us. And you know this, your hairs are numbered, you are more precious than the sparrow. These are very common verses that we hear Christians quoting many times. But a lot of people, they like to use this, they like to claim the promise of our hairs are all numbered. You know, are you not more precious than the sparrow? They like to claim all this promise without what? Without considering the context here. I mean, it is only, how can we not be afraid? You ask your heart, you ask your spirit, how can we not be afraid? It is only when we are doing the will of God, then you realize amazingly our heart can be at peace. Even though we are facing challenges, even though we are facing difficulties. On the contrary, in fact, if our heart, if you knowingly know that you are against the will of God, maybe you are dating someone against God's will, maybe you are using money against God's will, maybe you are departing away from God, maybe you are not even considering what God's words say. When we knowingly know that we are in such a state, we cannot fool ourselves, we cannot hypnotize ourselves to say that, oh, everything will be fine, you know, our hands are numbered, and God will be pleased with us. This context is in the this assurance that, you know, your hands are numbered. Aren't you more precious than sparrows? This is in the context of a person doing the will of God, and in the process of that, face a lot of hardships, resistance, oppositions, and God's assurance for us is this, that we have nothing to fear. You know, even Stephen, the most typical example that we have in the Bible, who actually died, he paid the highest price for following Jesus, he actually died. But despite that, the reason why we need not be afraid is, even so, Stephen himself, for as far as he is concerned, he can see the glory of God, and he can feel this transcending peace, even in the face of death. I mean, I believe no one can imagine that we'll be utterly peaceful in the face of death. I mean, we would like to imagine that, but until we face death, then you know whether we can be peaceful or not. But if we are consistently following God, just like Stephen, at the right time, God will give us the peace that we need, the courage that we need. So, a lot of times, yes, we cannot control the coming of persecutions, but we can still face persecution with courage because of God's promise. And God's promise to be with us doesn't mean that we will not be martyred, doesn't mean that everything will be fine, but it means that the greater the challenge, the higher the glory. I mean, it is not easy. I know every time I want to pray this, I want to preach this kind of message, I myself, first of all, struggle. It's like, this kind of message is, it's not the most palatable message. It's not the most pleasing to the ear message. Because, as I said, no one like a hard life. Everyone like an easy life. But the thing is, I was also thinking through in my heart that if we are not relying on the power of the Holy Spirit to deal with the cause of following Jesus, then actually, on the other hand, you know, our human spirit, our human life is very amazing. We are either influenced by the cross, the Holy Spirit, or we'll be influenced by the world. So if I'm not holding on to the power of the Holy Spirit to deal with all this potential opposition of being a Christian, on the other hand, we will be influenced by the power, or rather the force of ourselves, our desires. You know, the force of wanting something but not getting it. The misery of being tormented by sin, knowing that something we should get out of a certain vicious cycle in our life, but we just cannot get out from that sin, that addiction, that evil desires. You know, it's either one or the other. If we are not struggling with following with God, if we are not struggling with obeying the cross, on the other hand, we'll be struggling with, you know, comparing with others. Why am I not as good as others? Why don't I get the same good things as others? Why is it that people doesn't look up to me as much as they look up to others? We'll be battling with these other troubles of the world. And that's why, the reason why God wants to bring us into the path of the cross is, even if we face certain hardships, certain challenges, God wants us to go through the right challenges, worthy challenges, rather than challenges that will torment us, will give us pain, but in the end, ends up with no fruits. So the gospel will surely be proclaimed whether we participate in it or not. But God's assurance is, if we are willing to follow God, His assurance is with us. No matter what kind of threat we face, He will give us the support we need. So in view of the fact that we know, even if we do not want persecutions, it will come our way. And we know that in our Christian living, there will certainly be threats, but yet God has given us assurance. So how should we then respond? What are our responses to persecutions? What should be our responses to persecution? Now, God gave us certain things for us to ponder through. Let's read verse 23. Matthew 10, verse 23. when you are persecuted in one place. So this is one response. When you are persecuted in one place, flee to the other, to another. Truly, I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. So God says, do not be afraid. So don't be terrified. God already told us multiple assurance, but also do not need to deliberately remain in it, remain in the persecution. I mean, you know, God calls all of us to go on a grand, purposeful, meaningful mission. But God asks us to go on this mission courageously, boldly. Go in my name, be bold. Preach the gospel boldly. But God also doesn't want us to be foolish. God doesn't want us to be foolish. A lot of people tend to say, no, I have faith. You know, if I flee, it means I don't have faith. If I run away, if I do not take it on, head on, it means that I lack faith. I mean, this is not always the case. Because God also wants us to be wise. It is better, you know, some people say, no, I'm not afraid of death. You know, some people, they're very gung-ho, right? They say, I'm not afraid of death. You want to kill me, you kill me. But that may not be the wise will of God at a certain moment. Because even though it's glorious to be martyrs for Christ, but it's even better if you keep your life and live longer on earth, can go around more places, and then you can preach the gospel, advance the gospel even more. I mean, yeah, someone who is not afraid of imprisonment, you say, you come and catch me, put me in jail. But if you are confined in jail, of course, God can work through imprisonment also, you know. God can work through Paul during his imprisonment and so on. But it is even better, it is even smarter if you can freely roam about, travel more places, and bring the word in person to save other souls. So at different time, at different juncture, sometimes God says we can flee. It doesn't mean that when you flee, you are without faith. You are a coward. Sometimes God's will is that. But yet sometimes God's will is also for us to endure it when it comes. You know, like for example, Paul. Sometimes he flee. At a certain juncture, when he traveled in his itinerary, sometimes God asked him to run away because these people here are resisting. But sometimes God asked him to stay. And then God has different purpose. The key thing is, first of all, to know. We need to test God's will. And it is not always the case that when we run away, it means that we are selfish, we are coward, or we are without faith. So God allows us to sometimes flee. But then the question we need to ask ourselves is, can our faith, when we face all this persecution, it's not rather about running away or staying. Can our faith withstand tests? Let's read verse 32 to 39. So this is God's challenge and charge to us. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. And whoever finds their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. So here, find their life. Of course, we know for this context, it means, you know, whoever find their life, whoever prevent their life from being killed and so save their life, but in the process of it, they may deny Christ, they will lose their salvation. But of course, finding their life in today's context, especially in this Singapore context where there's no much very life and death persecution, finding life could be, you know, some people in the course of finding a life, you know, we always hear this phrase, get a life, pursue your desires, pursue your dreams, get a life. You know, some people, they get their life, they pursue their dreams, they run after the world, they get everything, and in the course of it, they sacrifice following God, they sacrifice knowing about eternal life, they sacrifice wanting to know about Jesus, they sacrifice wanting to build a relationship with Jesus. They just say, I want to get a life. Money is most important. I want to get a life. I want to find my Prince Charming. The rest doesn't matter. So in the course of getting a life that they want, they rather give up on eternal affairs. And that's why, because of that, whoever find their life, they actually paradoxically lose it. So for here, Jesus is trying to highlight how a true Christian will be when they will totally deny their life to follow God. So just now we mentioned, you know, when we say, so this is something we need to ask ourselves. When Jesus say he bring, we all know the gospel brings peace. But just now I already mentioned, this peace is only experienced by people who are willing to humbly accept God's help and God's favor. It doesn't mean that Jesus' peace means there's no wars, no tension between families and friends. We all know that. But Jesus was trying to, from this verse that he says here, you know, whoever disown me will be disowned by me, etc. He's trying to say that when we face certain life-threatening situation, that's when our faith, the true colors of our faith is being revealed. I mean, on day-to-day, on very normal circumstances, nobody can tell whether our faith, even you yourself may not know what's your faith level. We may think that our faith is all right. Only when our faith is put to the test, then you will know whether our faith is real or not. So, of course, I keep saying, we don't have what, lose their life, find their life. We don't have life-threatening issues here. But can our faith stand the test in the face of temptation, in the face of problems, in the face of varying situations? We need to ask ourselves this question. You know, just now, we read about this. If you disown me, a lot of people are very scared about this verse, right? If you disown me, I will also disown you before my Father in heaven. So, now, a lot of us here, if every time we read this kind of verse, you know, if you disown me, I will disown you, and you feel very scared, very accused, or sometimes in the course of our faith journey, if we always have the insinuation or the hint that God has disowned us, disowned you, then maybe we also need to reflect. Is it because a lot of times, before you even feel deserted or feel disowned by God, have we also already deserted God? Deserted God in a lot of our choices, our living. That's why we are fearful and we are accused. So we always say, you know, when we have fear, it means God's perfect love is not grounded in our life. Because perfect love drives out fear. So a lot of times we feel that God has disowned us, God don't care about us. You know, God, why do you lead me into this kind of misery in my life? Why do you allow this thing to happen in my life? Why is everything in my life so rocky, so not smooth? Why am I receiving a lot of hurts? I mean, if we think that God has moved out of our life, then before that, we need to ask ourselves, have we, in the first place, disowned God? Because just like I said, perfect love drives out fear. But what is love? God says, if you love me, you will obey me. You will keep my command. John 14:15. So, meaning to say that if we want to withstand the test of faith, if we want to remain in a reconciled relationship with God, we need to review and consider our choices. Response to persecution. There are certain options before us. When we face persecutions, when we face issues in life, there are options for us to choose. Just like, so it's between the suffering or the way of the cross or the weight of the world. I'm saying, you know, God is alive. Satan is as much alive also. So there's two paths set before us. I mean, the gospel carries with it a lot of blessings and benefits that we are aware. But recently, these 2 weeks, we have been sharing about the struggles, the challenges of the cross. So, yes, I know it's not easy to carry the cross. I mean, this is something that I'm still, even up to today, this is something that we need to consciously battle with every day. I mean, it's a battle, you know, to constantly put our desires to death. Sometimes you really want to do something, but you have to force yourself not to like something. It's very hard. It's a battle to constantly squeeze ourselves to like what's holy and hate what is evil. I mean, a lot of times we like what is evil. Wow, this evil thing is so funny, it's so entertaining, it's so relaxing, it's so soothing to our flesh. But it's so hard to love what is holy, you know. You know, it's so easy to shout when we feel angry, but it's so hard to swallow the anger in humility. So it's very hard to carry the cross sometimes. It's hard to put up with opposition to our faith. You know, when people say nasty things about us. But even though it's hard, I think we need to pause and consider and wait. Actually, and weigh the burden of the cross versus the burden of the world. And then from this weighing, then we can find the motivation to press ourselves to carry the cross. Because this is something that we need to think through in our heart. I don't know whether, you know, some of you, have you ever been tormented by sin? Or have you ever been tormented by unfulfilled desires? You keep chasing after the world, one thing after another. When we are young, we chase for good results, a lot of friends, fun, money. Then we chase already, another new thing come, and we want to chase after a new thrill, new things, new excitement. We need to weigh between unfulfilled wants, unfulfilled needs, a lot of insecurity, inferiority complex, a lot of even loneliness. That is the weight of the world, that comes with the weight of the world, versus the challenge of the cross. So after weighing, then we can ask ourselves, which would we rather bear? So this is a very realistic. I mean, God purposely wants us to sit down and think through this hard decision. You know, a lot of times when we sit down, think through certain hard decision, then we will not revert. We will not go back. We will not regress. We will not regret. So we need to think through. Yes, bearing the cross is hard. But there's two options. It's not as if oh, bearing the cross is so hard. I don't want to follow the cross. I don't want to take up the cross and follow Jesus. But it is not as if that if we do not take up the cross to follow Jesus, then we will be spared from the pains of the world. On the contrary, if we refuse to take up the cross to follow Jesus, the weight of the world, the pain of the world, will be even more unbearable for us. People of the world, they've been through death and separation, for example. Christians also will go through death and separation. But the way people of the world, they have to undertake death and separation is utter misery, without hope for the future, without hope for heavenly kingdom. Christians, when we go through death and separation, there's always a hope for a renewal. And people of the world, they also go through stress. Christians also go through stress. People of the world, they struggle with contentment issue, they struggle with entertainment issue, they struggle with loneliness issue. But when we are outside the cross, the loneliness is just for us to bear ourselves. It will be so heavy on us. So it doesn't mean that if a person finds the cross too heavy to bear, then the person, by forsaking the cross, will be spared the weight of the world. It doesn't work that way. On the contrary, the weight of the world will be even heavier upon the person who is without the support of the Holy Spirit. So we need to think, which would we rather bear? And then there's also, just now in Jesus' word, would you love God more or love man more? I mean, this is very hard to... anyone who loves the father, the mother, the son, the daughter more than me is not worthy to follow me. I mean, this is so hard. I mean, frankly speaking, sometimes when we have loving people around us, it's hard to say that we want to love God more because God is like quite distant. But people are always around us, within our touch. So when we want to check our faith, we need to ask ourselves, are we able to say yes? You know, are we able to love God more than men? But if your answer is a very helpless no, I cannot really love God more than men, then maybe we have to think hard and confirm deeply enough that all those people that we find it so hard to love more than God, actually, can they love us more than God does? I mean, even when we are not nice towards God, even when we are enemies towards God. God died for us. Can all those people that we love, our father, our mother, our spouse, our girlfriend, boyfriend, our best friend, can they even die for us? You know, sometimes your best friend, if you score higher marks than them, maybe they start to feel a bit sour. You don't know. Maybe they didn't say. I don't know. But you know, even the best friend, sometimes your best friend, they may not even be happy for you when you get married. You know, I think I shared before. There was once a sister shared with me, wow, she's very sad because at her wedding day, her best friend didn't come. Because why? Her best friend just broke up and the best friend feel very sour that she can get married. It's so heartbreaking sometimes. How come human relationship can be so fragile? The person that you love a lot, they cannot even be happy for you when you're happy, at the happiest moment of your life. So when we find it so hard to love men and to love God more than men, we need to ask ourselves, does anyone that we care for actually love us more than God? And this is, when we face persecution, this is an important question, because many a times, the members of our household are the ones who oppose us and who has the greatest impact on our faith. You know, if a neighbor opposed my faith, I wouldn't think about it too much. But if my father opposed my faith, I may shake. You know, the impact is that if my colleague opposed to me being a Christian, I may not care about what he say. Who cares about what he say? You want to think whatever you can think, he can think about it. But if my spouse, if my husband opposed my faith, it's going to shake me a lot. So when we face persecution from the people around us, this is something we need to really think through, and we really need to weigh through. And God also says, whoever acknowledge me. So we need whoever acknowledge me or whoever disown me will be also correspondingly be acknowledged or disowned by me before my Father. We also need to consider that. I mean, by the way, when we talk about God and man, you know, sometimes I know we have all different kind of interpersonal situation, but in my life and as I look around me, I realize that sometimes perhaps God allows certain failures in interpersonal relationship to also help us realize, make us realize that no one loves us more than God. Sometimes the little disappointment with men may not be very big. It may not be a very big betrayer, but a little inconsideration of men, sometimes God allows us to face this kind of hurts from men, just to remind us, don't place hope on even the one whom you think you love most and whom you think love you most, because no one loves us more than God. So do not be deceived. Then back to this acknowledging and denying God or disowning God. Of course, as I always say, nobody is going to point a gun at you in Singapore and say, if you would deny Christ, or if you, unless you deny Christ, I will shoot you in the head. Nobody will do that here. But here we need to ask ourselves. You know, a lot of times we feel we got deserted, we got abandoned by God. Like He's not answering our prayers. I've been praying, I've been calling to you, God, for help so many times. But why is it that my prayers doesn't seem to be answered? Before that, we need to consider, have we been directly, knowingly or unknowingly denying Christ in living our life? For example, you know, every time when we don't feel like praying when we have issues, we rather groan and moan on our bed, but we refuse to pray. We rather grumble, but we refuse to pray. That is disowning God, disowning the power of prayer. You know, when we trust our feelings and our conclusion more than God's word, we are actually disowning Christ, disowning the power, the truth of His word. So a lot of times, even Christians, Christians sometimes they make this bold statement. No matter how weak I am, I will never deny Christ because I know He's the only God who can bring us to heaven. Now, I ever make this boasty claim in my heart before. I say, no matter how weak I am, at least one thing I may not do is, unless somebody point a gun at me, that one I don't know. But I always have this proud thinking in my mind that the last thing I'll do is to deny Christ because Christ is the only God who can bring me to heaven. But then I realized actually sometimes in the course of my living, I may unknowingly be living a life as if I have denied Christ. You know, sometimes I trust my feelings, my thinking, my conclusion more than what God says. So that is denying Christ. Sometimes we depend on our wisdom or even depend on the help from other humans more than depending on God. That is also denying Christ, denying Christ's ability. And sometimes when we delight ourselves or when we find joy in other things other than Christ, then we are denying Christ of his charisma, of his attractive power. A lot of times we just, in big and small things in our life, we indirectly have actually denied Christ, which is why it leads to a corresponding perception in our spirit that we also feel as if God has abandoned us. This is interrelated. Of course, I have to emphasize, at a salvational standing level, if we believe in Christ, we will still be like Lot, ultimately end up in heaven. But in the course of our living, sometimes we will feel as if God disowned us. Like we are fighting our own battles on earth. Like we are being lonely and we are being very miserable on earth. Because a lot of times, we didn't really acknowledge God in everything that we do. And if in the face of, especially this few months and this 1 year, we have been talking about end times. If we are not willing or purposefully setting ourselves up on an evangelizing journey, then we are actually denying Christ of his urgent mission. Because when we know that people are fast perishing around us, and we did nothing, not even to pray about saving souls, we are actually denying Christ's mission. So the question is, we need to ask ourselves, are we really acknowledging Christ in everything that we do? Because when we acknowledge him in everything that we do, then his threefold, not don't be afraid, then his assurance will become our assurance. But the reason why we often lack assurance in our heart is because a lot of times we may not be entirely doing his will in our life. So we know that God is a faithful God. Genuine commitment will surely bring about true blessings. All these are hard. To choose the cross, all these are hard. But God's principle is when we have a genuine commitment towards him, he will surely make his blessings fulfilled, his promises fulfilled in our life. So we have to ask ourselves, do we truly understand what does it mean by we are fully redeemed by God? You know, being saved by God, is it just a very lofty, a very empty idea in our mind? Or is it just a feel-good sensation in our hearts? How do you know that you are truly aware? How do you know that you have truly understood that you are saved by grace? Saved by God. How do you know? If a person truly understood that he is totally redeemed, he will surely have this understanding that my life now belongs to the one who saved me. I mean, you don't even need to talk about salvation, God and us matter. If today I almost die and a fellow human saved me, for the rest of my life, I will want to repay this human benefactor. How much more God? So if we truly understood that we have been saved by God, then naturally our inkling will be, we will want our life to be used by God. So if we say that we have tasted the grace of redemption, but when we look at people around us, when God tells us to bear the cross and to reach out to suffering people around us, and we have no conviction at all, then we need to rethink. Have we really understood the meaning of being saved by grace? Because even human-to-human encounter, sometimes, for example, if people who have been through poverty, they will have empathy when they see another poor person. People who have been through sickness, they see another person in illness, they will have the compassion to reach out to them. People who have been through relational breakup, they will have empathy with people who fail in their relationship. This happens even between human-to-human encounter. So if we recognize that we are a sinner who has been saved, when we look at fellow perishing souls and say we are not moved at all to even pray for them, then we need to rethink. Have we really understood the meaning of redemption? So what do we want to choose today? Today, do we want to choose the way of the cross or the way of the world? Because persecutions come one way or another. Even when you reject the cross, it doesn't mean that life will be rosy for us. Because the weight, the temptation, the accusation, the burden of sin and the world will also come to us. But if we are willing to carry the cross, God will be faithful. And he says that those of us who share in his suffering will also share in his glory if we bear our cross. And people who receive, and anyone who welcomes Christ, or welcome us, will also share in our reward. Okay, let's read the final part of the passage for today. Verse 40. Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes, so Jesus said, anyone who welcomes you, my disciple, welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Here, we just read welcome, welcome. You thought welcome is hello, shake hand, and it's a very simple hospitality. No, but actually in the background of the persecution back then, this is life-threatening hospitality. Because in the background of persecution, anyone who welcomed the disciples can be guilty of harboring wanted men. So that's very severe. It could even cost them their life. So this is only serious believer. They would be able to do this. And so when we talk about, when we see this verse 40, it's very amazing. Do you see a very powerful connection here? Because here he says, if anyone welcomes you, so it's, you can put me, you can refer to yourself. If anyone welcomes you, it is the same, it is equal to them welcoming me. The me is Jesus in that context. And that is equal to Father God. Anyone who welcomes Jesus, welcome the one who sent me, Father God. So this is an amazing. So if you look at this equation, you equal to Jesus, equal to Father God. Meaning to say that, no, we thought we are a nobody. We thought we are very useless, lousy. If we commit our life to do the will of God, actually, we are the representative of God. So we need not take our life lightly, because everything we do, even our failures, even our weakness, can be used to glorify God. So we continue reading verse 41. 31, whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. Verse 42, and if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. Okay, so here the reward. What's the reward? Anyone who receives a prophet, a righteous man, and the lowest of Christ's disciples, their reward is what all these people bring. What does a prophet, what does a righteous person, and a disciple of Christ bring? They bring the gospel and they bring salvation. So anyone who receives, in other words, anyone who receives God's followers, they receive what these followers of God bring, which is salvation, eternal life, and a relationship with God. So here we see, there's an interesting, when you read verse 41 to 42, you see that there's a hierarchy from the highest to the lowest. In this, in the hierarchy of Christ's followers, who is the most, the one with most authority? The prophet, or today, the pastor. And then a righteous person, a holy Christian. Even to the lowest, the little one, some Christian who have half-hearted faith, no one leg in the world, one leg in the church, Christians who are inexperienced, Christians who may not know the gospel well, Christians who may not talk well, Christians who may not even finish reading the whole Bible once, Christians who may not pray every day, you know, a lot of weak little ones, Christians. So, but from the highest to the lowest, whether you are the pastor, whether you are the deacon, whether you are the cell group leader, whether you are just a normal, very weak Christian, but if you bring the message of the cross, if you bring God's message, God will deem you as important and glorious. So here, we need to get this assurance that, you know, a lot of times we may think that we belong to, you know, I think very few of us here will classify ourselves as a prophet or the righteous person. Maybe some of us will say that we are a righteous person. Very few dare to say we are a righteous person. A lot of us tend to say, feel that we are the little one. You know, I don't even know how to pray. I don't even know how to tell the Holy Spirit's perfect will. I don't even know how to discern spiritual right from wrong. I don't even have love, selfless love. But here it says, even if you are the little, the lowliest of all, but no, we have no exceptional qualities. We may be inexperienced even in shepherding or proclaiming God's word, but you will receive the love, the respect, the intercession of other sheep of the Lord if you are willing to invest your life in the path of the cross. This is God's assurance. Because God values everyone who contribute to his message, to extend his ministry. So here we see two parts. There is, on the one hand, we are a follower of Christ. So even though you are, we may be weak, we may not be perfect, but God promised that he will provide, even in the midst of persecution. This is set in the time of persecution. So God promised, even though all these threats that I've listed out to you is real, you may be sometimes flogged in the synagogues, you may be sometimes brought before the authorities, you may be sometimes facing persecutions from your own household. That is all true. You may come to a point where everyone hates you. That's what the Bible says. But even in the midst of persecutions, if you are my faithful follower, I will provide for you. I will find people who can welcome you. There will be people who will be able to, who will be willing to extend this hospitality to you because of the fact that you are my follower. So this is, on the one hand, we are follower of Christ, we can be assured that God will provide for us whatever we need. On the other hand, how do we treat? So we should also, this verse also is a verse for people who respond, who treat, who receive the followers of God. So we are both, for all of us sitting here, most of us sitting here, we are both a follower and also a respondent to followers of Christ. So even if you extend a little cup of water, and it's not just water, a little cup of cold water, just a cold water, it will earn us rewards from God. So even our any kind treatment, any little intercession, whatever, even our eager thirst for God's word, our earnest interest in knowing God, every little thing, all this will not be forgotten by God. So God's word for us encourages us that he is a faithful God. Even in dire situation, he still reigns. He still will make his sheep bless one another. Even though it's in hard times, I pray that as we recap today's message, we really have to go through certain serious prayer, because this is not an easy topic for us to accept. But whether you like it or not, you know, whether you like it or not, trials and the challenges of the cross will come at us, whether we like it or not. And a wise and blessed sheep of God will weigh and come to the understanding that even if I do not carry the cross, if I do not carry the cross, I will have to tolerate the turmoil, the accusations of sins in my heart, which is thousandfold, maybe more torturous than the path of the cross. So I pray that as we think through this message, God will give us these open eyes to help us realize that even though the cross has challenged, it is not as challenging as we willfully want to follow the world. It's not as pain as we willfully want to walk in our own way. So I pray that God give us assurance that as we read through, even though there's challenges, God's word can be our assurance. God's nature of love, God's nature of righteousness can be our strength. Okay, let's pray. Father God, we thank you tonight, today, this evening, Lord, for giving us this important word of yours. Lord, this is a necessary word because, Lord, we know that you want to make us a real follower of Christ. You do not just want to massage our ego. You do not just want to give us a false sense of hope and a good feeling. But, Lord, thank you for preparing us, telling us that whether we follow you in the world or not, there will be troubles in this world. But when we cling our lives to you, all these troubles will be turned into opportunities to lift up the name of Christ, will be turned to opportunities to taste your love, taste your grace. So Lord, give us the wisdom, give us the courage, give us the willingness today to really take up the cross and follow you. And in the course of it, taste your faithful provision and your faithful support for us. Lord, as we confirm your word again later in the forum, please bless our sharing and guide that all of us, as we share together, our faith will be lifted up. And I pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.